Gang problem in Los Angeles is a historical one. It was the birthplace of many of the gangs that are currently spreading across the United States, whether they be the Latino gangs, 18th Street, MS-13, or the black gangs, the Crips and the Bloods. They all had their birthplace in the city of Los Angeles in the 50s, 60s, and 70s. And what we are dealing with today is a continuation of that multi-generational phenomenon.
And when I look at this from the perspective of 43 years in the Los Angeles County Sheriff's Department, I've seen what was once a benign problem become one of the most vexing and threatening realities of Los Angeles County. And it's all happened on my watch, as they say.
It's kind of like a personal journey for me, because I started in the old hardcore suppression model and benefited from it. I loved being a gang officer, you know, and I've seen this from every phase, and now I'm seeing it from a completely different aspect, and I see it working.
For me, as a civil rights lawyer, what civil rights do you have if you don't have safety? Safety is the first civil right. So all of our lawsuits and all of the victories that we had were not keeping these communities safe.
Well, who's better prepared to do this than those that wear the uniform and are supposed to keep the community safe? And the question is, how do you do this better? And I'm willing to stick my neck out as an elected official and say that we need to do things better. We need to respect the fact that our capacity to lead is stronger. Deputies need to be community leaders and community organizers in order for us to deal with this gang problem effectively. We will not arrest our way out of the gang problem, but we're not also going to police our way out of the gang problem.
And as one cop, a gang cop in LA said, Sergeant Pierce said, you know, Connie, these kids don't stand a chance. And that's what I hate about my job, is that, you know, I want to be able as a cop to be able to give these kids some hope. And instead, I'm just here to arrest them. And I want to help you change that.
How do you get a department that's really good at arresting people to take on the rest of the strategy?
The LAPD was an arrest machine. They described themselves as a hook 'em and book 'em. The satisfaction of the individual officer, the measurement of success of the organization, was in its arrest statistics. And they did a hell of a job. Every year, lock 'em up, and every year, crime went up. And every year, racial antagonism went up. Two of the worst race riots in the history of America were, in many respects, a direct result of that mentality. As part of a focus group study that's being undertaken in my department, interviews are being done of all my captains. And I have a captain, Captain Bob Green. He could be the poster boy for the Los Angeles Police Department of the old and the new. He is the white captain of the 77th area. 154 murders in 1989 when he was working there as a young sergeant. He's now the captain. So far this year, I think he's had, Charlie, three murders so far this year? Less than 10 in a command that used to generate over 150 a year. He, in response to a question from the interviewer about the how the culture and the philosophy of the department was changing, talked about, well, the attitude, the philosophy of the department used to be hook 'em and book 'em. And he says, that's no longer what we're into. He says, the future is not in handcuffs. Just think of that comment from a captain of police in the Los Angeles Police Department working in what was at one time the most dangerous area of that city. The future is not in handcuffs.
Some of the folks that are watching this may not have multi-generational gangs now, but you will. When we do gang search warrants, we take Department of Children and Family Services with us with the express purpose of pulling the kids out of the home that are doomed to relive this and getting them placed and putting them into adoption or to foster homes. Because the reality is that if they continue down the path of their grandparents, this is a death sentence.
In LA, we have spent $25 billion, with a B, in the last 30 years on a war on gangs. We now have six times as many gangs and twice as many gang members. We're reducing crime, but we're not blocking the transmission of the mindset. The culture has metastasized. And it's now taking over youth culture. Look at our kids. Listen to their music. Look at how they dress. We've allowed gang culture to infect youth culture. And if we don't stop it, it'll become the culture. We've been handing out fly swatters for a malaria epidemic. You have to drain the swamp, get rid of all standing water. You have to train the population to put on the insecticide. You have to hand out the nets and train the parents to make sure the kids are sleeping under the nets. You have to do a lot of things. You have to change the conditions in that ecosystem that spawn the disease. That's what this model is. And Sheriff Baca and Chief Bratton have said, we want that. That's how we got together.
The concept is called cops on the dots, hotspot policing, focus policing, to concentrate police resources in relatively small areas where the gang activities are most prevalent, most pronounced, and most damaging to the public. Understanding who is a member of the gang, of what gang, and where that gang seeks to operate and where that gang seeks to exert control. One of the reasons we've been having so much success is that the police are no longer just attempting to deal with this issue on their own. What can we do about the issue of gangs that is not just a suppression solution, that is what LA has been engaged in for most of its history, but focuses on also combining intervention, prevention, and reentry strategies and programs together into a seamless coordination between law enforcement partners, community partners, criminal justice partners, and political leadership, so that everybody is in the game and everybody is effectively, it's like we're in a lifeboat, and we're all rowing in the same direction. We're rowing together.
You can put police officers on every corner. You can go to every documented gang member's house. You can do that for a short amount of time. But it does a couple of things. Several of them are not good. One thing it does is it will reduce gang crime in the short run. But it coalesces the gang. It causes them to form a cohesive unit, which is with the police as a common enemy. So you make the gang stronger when you do that. One of the key stakeholders in this is your police officers. They will not embrace this without effort and without leadership, because this is counterintuitive to them, that you might be reaching out to a former gang member to try to influence a current gang member. That doesn't make sense to them, because they see this, you know, our cars are black and white for a reason. You know, they see, oftentimes when you're at the beginning of your career, you see things in black and white. And so these shades of gray and these things that can improve the problem sometimes escape them. You can do a number of things. One is a leadership issue. The boss has got to believe in this, and not just talk about it, but believe in it. And then, additionally, you know, middle management has to support that, you know, because they can tell when you're just doing it because the chief told you to. So that's very important. So you have to sell it at that level. We reinforce it through CompStat and through other methods, so that it stays at the forefront of middle managers' minds. But even more important, it has to get embraced at the street supervision level.
I think the time now is to be a part of all things to solve the gang problem and not stand back and say, we're enforcement only. For example, in my department, the Sheriff's Department, we have 14 youth centers. Then we have a VITA program, which is a Saturday boot camp for not the sake of just learning how to march and count, but to learn how to solve problems at home, at school, with life, and in the neighborhood. And so we become like surrogate parents for an 8-hour period of time on Saturdays.
You can't do this stuff if you don't have strategic policing that has reduced the violence to a level where you can do these kinds of programs. Wrap around school safety. School activities that go to 11 o'clock at night. You can't shackle the doors of the schools at 3. You got to keep the schools open. Every single venue, the parks, the schools, the swimming pools, the libraries. You realize the kids in some parts of LA won't go to the libraries because the gangs have taken over the computer terminals. So it's an ecosystem strategy. First of all, it's the police and the mayor and the council have to decide that they're going to go from isolated programs to full team. This model requires all of those services to be united under one strategy for hold and build. So what you're doing is you're organizing the whole neighborhood. You have to invest in the local leadership, and you don't come in with an already made plan. You come to the community leaders and you say, this model requires probation and child services to be working together. It requires all of our educational teams to be working with probation and child services. It requires all of the bureaucracies in our alphabet soup city halls and county governments to join together. You realize these bureaucracies don't even meet together? Never mind, plan a plan with the community for how do you keep every kid in that neighborhood safe. We don't meet together, we don't plan together, we don't coordinate. It's all silos. So this is a cross-siloed, multidisciplinary effort. We need LAPD to patrol in a different way when the kids are walking to school, make sure they get to school safely. They're safe in the hallways. You have to have patrols in the hallways because the gang recruiters are in the hallways. The hardest thing, it's not the police. The police have been the biggest pushers of this new way of doing business, this joint, cooperative, all-hands-on-deck ecosystem strategy. It's the bureaucracies that don't want to cooperate with each other that are the problem. It's politicians who aren't going to be there for long term. They're looking for their next office and they don't want to invest in the collective bargaining. Because think about how you have to change, for example, in the summer night lights. You have to secure the parks. The parks have to stay open until 2 in the morning. Well, you have to go to the union and say, for your young people that don't have families, can they stay on duty from 10 o'clock until 3 o'clock in the morning? That requires you to change how you do business. You're not just writing memos to a politician. You're actually out in the community executing a safety plan. And it requires the work to be done differently. It means lawyers like me don't spend their time suing the police. It means I'm spending more of my time in Parker Center and at the sheriff's headquarters now. I'm not suing them anymore. I had to change how I did business. I'm pursuing the same goal, which is safe kids in poor neighborhoods. But I'm now working with my former opponents, and I'm not suing them. That's a big change for a lawyer. If I can make that kind of change, these other bureaucracies and these bureaucrats can make the change they need. Where's the public health department? You never see the public health department in joint meetings. This is a public health strategy. And finally, you have to get the training. And we're just developing a training institute to be able to train schools. Librarians need to be trained because they're one of the main catch basins for kids. They keep a lot of the kids after school. They need reinforcement. You need to be able to evaluate the programs that work. So there's a lot of track to be laid for these new trains, and that's what we're doing right now.
Gang detectives, homicide detectives that work gangs in many parts of the city totally embrace this because they see this as one of two things. Something that does two things. One is it helps them to solve their crimes, because as you build trust with gang intervention and with community groups, you get information. Not necessarily from the intervention workers, but it comes to you because they are a strong part of the community. And if it's seen that you're trusted by them, then there is trust extended from that relationship throughout the community. So you start getting information. And then second, it reduces their workload. If you can get to the point where your homicide detectives talk to you, not me talking to them, but them talking to me, about how they're taking steps to stop the next homicide, then you have it. You have cemented the change in your culture. Once detectives see their role as stopping the next crime, not just not just investigating the last crime, particularly in gang crimes, then you've achieved your goal. You know, and you have, at least you're getting traction on this, and you're making progress towards not just a top-down approach, but something that has actually got grassroots support. And that's the goal in this.
We have had thousands of kids who are teetering, straighten out their lives. We've had one kid in our youth activities program who became a medical doctor. We have other kids, of course, that join law enforcement. Many go into the military because in our VITA program, we have the Marine Corps and the Air Force and the Army backing us up with the Saturday programs that we do. So they get attracted to that possible way of starting a responsible life. And the key success is the adult interaction. Because once they go through the program, they still know how to access the deputies who are leading the program. And those deputies have truly been the transformers of these kids' lives because they are the key point of how that individual builds trust with an adult. And thus the deputies, and I think all cops have this ability, quite frankly, they are good leaders. It's just that we have to break them out of that radio car role and give them the freedom to interact with these at-risk youth. And the testimonies are not just within the kids, it's the parents.
People can get a little overwhelmed with thinking that this is too complicated to do when it really isn't. The first thing you have to have is an agreement that our vision of how we do business in our city has to change. If you have a gang problem or you have a violence and youth problem, you have to be able to go after the following steps. Number one, you've got to agree to the vision. It's no longer business as usual. Everybody has to get in the boat and row together. Number two, there needs to be someone in charge of these projects, somebody who's in charge of the coordination. In Los Angeles, for example, Mayor Villaraigosa hired LA's first gang czar. The third thing you've got to have is you've got to develop the plan with the local people in the neighborhood. If you come in with a ready-made one-size-fits-all, you will fail. You've got to use data. And then you go into the community and you conduct focus groups to do the assessment so you can figure out not just what the gangs are, but where are the churches? Where are the mosques? Where are the temples? You know, where is the good stuff too? So the assets and the problems in a community. We can tell you where the crack houses are, the nuisance properties, the dangerous parks, the gang territories. Spit out those maps and analyze those neighborhoods and figure out. Then go to the leadership in those neighborhoods and say, this is what we're seeing in your neighborhood. Tell us what kind of strategy that you want to see. Develop with us a plan to keep every kid in this neighborhood safe. What do we need to do with our parks? What do we need to do with our swimming pools? What do we need to do with our arts programs after school? Where are soccer leagues? Where are the athletic programs? Can they go till 11 o'clock at night? You have to have park and recs at the table. You have to have everybody at the table contributing to the wraparound strategy. And the battle inside police departments is going to rage for a while, just like it's raging in City Hall. They don't want to change how they do business. But for officers on the ground, it's like, lady, you are crazy. I get promoted for how many people I arrest. I'm not going to get promoted for creating relationships. Plus, I'm on my way to a specialized unit. I want to join SWAT.
What we've finally come to appreciate in the 21st century, looking back at the successes in the late 20th century in dealing with crime, is that all the stakeholders have to be engaged together. So what you have to work at is, in many respects, put ego aside, put parochial interests aside, and understand that we all have to come together and work for the common good. It's like an orchestra. An orchestra is made up of many great talents, violinists, lead violinists, and people on the horns and people on the strings. Each of those individuals accomplished in their own right, but they agree to come together and share in the creation of a beautiful piece of music.
Police are a moral authority. And yet when you're just doing enforcement only, the heroic side of that moral authority is contained in one area, overcoming threatening, fearful situations and managing them. Well, our police in America do this better than any police in the world, because we have so much of it here. And our deputy sheriffs and police are the best kind of leaders you could want. But we don't give them expanded responsibility for using the moral authority to change the whole community into a place where everyone feels secure, safe, and trustful of each other. So what I'm talking about is public trust policing. And public trust policing means your mission should never be devoid of public support. If the public doesn't trust the average deputy sheriff in the street, I have a problem, and I'm the leader, and I want my deputy to be a community respected person. I want them to not be feared. I want them to have this sense of people will seek them out when they have problems. You see, we should never run from problems or say we're too busy or it's not my responsibility, you're not committing a crime, so that's not my problem. We should run to helping people in a society with solving their problem, giving them the right direction. Oh yes, the clinic for AIDS treatment is over here, I'll give it to you. The ability to get a drug treatment program is over there, I'll give you the address. That we are the coordinator of solutions as well as the community organizer. That's basically where we are.
If law enforcement alone owns this problem, then you will fail. The law enforcement is not the answer to this. Just like law enforcement didn't create street gangs, law enforcement cannot end the conditions that create street gangs or end the crime that street gangs generate. So you have to reach out. You have to go to the hospitals. You have to think about intervention programs, hardcore intervention, where you may be dealing with gang members who respond to scenes to calm violence and try to stop the next crime. You know, you have to look at this as not a retrospective problem where you're just about solving the last gang crime and locking up whoever did that. You have to get in front of this. And that's what this whole strategy is about, is trying to get in front of the problem and trying to reduce the flow of youth into gangs. And that is the only solution here. You know, we have 41,000 gang members in Los Angeles. You know, there are our jails are full. We are extremely successful at enforcement opportunities, but that's not going to fix this.
One officer who really didn't want to do this under Chief Bratton, he was assigned to the Safer Cities Unit, and it's a unit that they ride bicycles, they get out of the squad cars, they walk the streets, they bond with the community, they find out who the kids are, they go into the schools. So it's more of the traditional footbeat kind of policing. And this sergeant did not want to do it. He kicked and screamed and he said, I'm not a social worker. What do I look like? A nurse? You know, this is women's stuff. He just didn't want to do it at all. He came to my office about, 18 months afterwards, and he came in and he said, Ms. Rice, I never thought I'd say this. He said, there was a little old grandmother. She hated me. I'd arrested her, two of her grandsons. She thought LAPD was the devil in black and white. And we accidentally hit her fence and knocked it over. And in the old days, we would have just knocked it over and said, that's the cost of doing business. He said, I came back with a hammer and nails, and as part of the safer policing, you have to fix her fence. So he fixes her fence, and then he starts asking her, what do you need? She says, well, you know, there's a pit bull over here, and he keeps wandering in my, so he gets animal control. And he just helped her solve about three problems. And then he noticed, he says, when I walk by or I drive by in the squad car, now she waves. She used to give me a single finger wave, but now she waves with her full hand. I get a full hand wave. And the other day, she picked up the phone and said, you know the shooting that happened in front of the church. This is who did it. And he had come by my office to tell me, you know, it works. It works.
I stumbled in the darkness, I'm lost and alone. Though I said I'd go before us and show the way back home. There's a light up ahead, I can't hold on very long. Forgive me, pretty baby, but I always take the long way home. Money's just something you throw off the back of a train. Got a head full of lightning, a hat full of rain. And I know that I've said I'll never do it again. I show back your passion. Your love's the only thing I've ever known. One thing for sure, pretty baby, I always take the long way home. Finally be alone. Come with me.